Dr. Chandu, you are truly an inspiration. Really.
I'm so happy.
I loved your talk.
Good
morning. Good morning, everyone. Before we start, I would like to thank the ISACA Mumbai Chapter, Mr. Fernando, for organizing such a lovely event. She means tech. Yes, she does. And I'm truly honored to be here. Thank you so much. So, my journey in InfoSec. You know, a couple of days back, I read this saying, the greatest pleasure in life is in doing things that people say you cannot do. And that is something that has, that my life has really gone by. Not when I was younger, because I used to get, you know, I used to change my thoughts as per what people used to say. I started my journey when I was in 10th grade and I was deciding between science and maths. I was the topper in maths. And I wanted to take maths. And my friends asked me, why maths? What do you see ahead? What is the future? I said, I want to be an engineer. And I was told, engineer? A lady? You know, it's not for women. What will you do? You'll stand at construction sites in the heat. Is that what you want to do? And I said, oh no, yeah, you're right. That's not what I want to do. So I didn't take maths. And I took science. So I studied my 11th and 12th and I got admission in dentistry. So I went for the first day, I was wanting to be a dentist. And again, people told me, you know, dentistry is very tough. You know, women can't do this. And though at that time there were many women there, in the first year they will give you a cadaver to work with. And it's you know, it's stinking and all of that. I said, yes, you're right. This is not something I want to do. Luckily, I had also got admission in biophysics, so I went there. And, you know, at this time, I said, no, I'm not going to let others define who I am. I'm not going to let others tell me what I can and cannot do. I want to be a genetic engineer. So that's what I decided. I did biophysics. I did honors in biophysics. So, I don't know if you've seen all of this together. This is where I started, honors in biophysics. After doing BSc honors, I got admission in masters, and that's when I came to Mumbai. My nephew's birthday, first birthday, I came. And I was told that Balaji is holding auditions. And it is impossible to get through. I said, why is it so impossible? And some of my friends were going and they were practicing for months on it. And I said, let's just go. It sounds like fun, you know. And for a science student who's been working for so many years of her life and studying, I said, okay, this is going to be different. Let's go and have some fun. So I went for the audition and I was selected. To my surprise and everyone else's surprise, that was not tough. Believe me, the audition was easy. What was tough was to convince my parents. And here I want to tell you who my parents are. My father is a colonel in the army and a strict colonel at that. And my mother was a principal for 20 years.
Oh, dear.
She was a secondary board examiner. She was teaching English and geography. And I went back home and I told them, I want to leave honors in biophysics and I want to do acting. They were like, are you mad? What is wrong with you? Now, my father is in his best mood early morning at 6 a.m. And nobody in the family wakes up so early. Because, come on. We've done that when we were young, when Papa had a say. We used to wake up at 5, go for horse riding, go for swimming, go for everything. When we got a little older and we could speak for ourselves, we said, okay, that's it, you're not going to wake up so early. So I decided the best way to convince him is to wake up at 6 a.m. So for 1 month, and believe me when I say this, 1 month, I woke up at 6 a.m. every day. And I went to my father and I said, please, please let me do this. Please let me do just 1 year. You know, my professor said, if I come back after 1 year, I can still do acting. I mean, I can still go back to biophysics. Just let me do this for 1 year. I've studied so hard, let me do this. For 1 month, I kept convincing him. After 1 month, I don't think he was convinced, but he was sick of me. So he said, just go. And I know if you've, there's this movie, I'm going to say this, he said, just in the genius, he's in the lead. So I said, okay, so I'm going to do acting now. But he said, there's one condition, your mother's going to go with you and she's going to be there for every shot, for everything. So yes, this is me in acting, and I started with a small role in Kahani Ghar Ghar Ki. I was told getting a lead role is impossible. I slogged and I got my first lead. I got my second lead. I decided let's do some negative roles. I started doing some negative roles. It was wonderful. It was very tough, but I did it. Now the problem with the field acting is, especially television, when you're working 18 to 20 hours a day. And then there's a time when you're not working. And when you're not working, you're pretty much doing nothing. So this is where I am today. Now the question is how and why I became an entrepreneur. I mean, how did this bug bite? This is the answer. I got married. So for most women, they say when they get married, the career's over. But for me, that's where, yes, it was restarted. I got married and I was working at the time. I was doing television and there was a time when there was a slump and I had nothing to do. So I was home and, you know, for a workaholic who's used to working 18 to 20 hours, sitting at home and not doing anything is killing. So my husband saw this and said, come to office.
What will I do in your office?
You know, when we were engaged, it took me, when people would ask me, what does your husband do? It would take me 2-3 minutes to explain. He is in information security. He's a consultant, you know, white hat hackers. It would take me 2 minutes to explain. And now he's telling me, come to office. So I said, what am I going to do in office? So he said, okay, see, I'm going to be traveling. So just come to office, sit there. Because people will work. I want to make sure that everyone is not on Facebook and playing games. They will get a little scared when they see you. Just come and sit in office. Even if you are sitting and playing games. I said, okay, let's go. So I went and I was sitting in office. And I think I learned by osmosis just sitting in that office. And one day I sat when he was taking interviews. And how many times have you seen this while conducting an interview? In InfoSec, many times. So I realized that, you know, the questions he was asking, 80% of the candidates did not know the answers. He had put a system there and he would tell them, okay, do this, and they couldn't. So I was a little put off and I said, are your questions that tough? Why are you such a tough interviewer? Make it easier. So he said, no, I'm not that tough. They have experience. They have the certification, so they should be able to answer these questions. So then why is it that they were not able to answer the questions? Okay, can you see this picture? If I tell you, theoretically, how to kick this ball, the ball is going to come at so many miles an hour. You need to jump up in the air, kick the ball, make sure you put your arms down so that you don't fall and break your head. And I teach you very well. Theoretically, very well. Do you think you can do this?
No.
You can't do it till you practice it about 100 times. So, what we are expecting from the freshers is actually to put a rabbit out of the hat. We are not giving them the practical experience. And when they come for interviews, we expect them to know the things. Practically, how will they? It's not possible. 2 million. This is what ISACA predicts will be the global shortage of cybersecurity professionals by 2019. This is the demand. Where is the supply? All of us want to hire only experienced people. Nobody wants to give freshers a chance. How do freshers learn? There is a gap. So we realized this gap and we said, let's bridge this gap. The need of the hour is to give practical knowledge, to give people the labs and the tools to work on, to not just say, here is the ball and this is what you have to do, but to actually take them on the field and let them do it. To let them speak to experts, to learn from the experts, understand what were the problems that they faced, learn from the problems. Then when they go for an interview, they will clear an interview. They will have the answers to every question. Right? Now, this is the IAS journey. We started in 2008. I have to tell you the story when we started. So, you know, normally people say I started from a little cabin. I didn't get a little cabin. I started from one chair. Our office was quite small and KK told me that's one chair in the sales cabin and that's yours and that's one desk space, that's it. And for someone, I didn't even do computers in my college, in my school, for someone with absolutely zero knowledge in computers, to think of starting an information security training company, it was impossible. So he told me, okay, first order of the day, we have to make a website. So before that, why don't you just make a rough draft of what all needs to go in and give it to me and then I will improve it a little bit and we'll put it on, we'll make our website. Okay, that sounds good. So I went and this is what most people do. I opened 3-4 training company websites. I copy pasted a little from here and I said, wow, my document is ready. I was like very proud of myself and I went to KK and I said, here's my document. He opens it, does something on a system. Now I know what he did that time. I was like, okay, what is he doing? And after 2 minutes, he says, these are the 5 websites that you've copy pasted from. This, my dear, is called plagiarism. And I was like, oops. So I was really sad because I was caught. And I said, okay. But I also that time decided no. Because he told me, if this is how you're going to do it, don't. So I said, no, I've decided to do this. Everybody's saying it's impossible for an actor to come and run an IT security training company, so let's do this. So I spent the next 1 month reading up on information security, understanding what it was, what is vulnerability assessment, what is penetration testing, what is a white hat hacker, what is a gray hat hacker. And this time I made the same document myself. And I went back to him. And of course, it was not perfect, but it was a good starting point, and that's how we started and made our website. And we started the Institute of Information Security. Now, when we started, NII used to do a lot of corporate trainings. So when we started doing trainings, we were doing trainings for professionals. And I realized this is not really helping to solve the problem. We need to not only train professionals, but we need to train freshers. That's how we will get a bigger workforce. And I said, okay, we start off with a course which is from the basics. We also were getting a lot of calls from freshers who maybe want to learn ethical hacking. So I told our technical team at NII, I said, let's design a course from basics. So they came back to me and they said, okay, we teach network security, database security, web appsec, and a little bit of compliance, and that's it. I said, hold on. Before we teach network security, let's teach network basics. And they look at me and say, ma'am, everybody knows network basics. No, they don't. Everybody doesn't know network basics. Let's start from the basics. They were not very happy with me at that time, but we did plan the course, and that is the CIC course that we started. It is a course from the beginner's level. We teach the basics and then we go on to the advanced level. So that is, in 2010, we started a Hyderabad branch. Now, this is also very interesting because a Hyderabad partner would not like to talk to me. He would only talk to KK. Every time I would send him an email and I would put KK in CC, the reply would come to KK and I was deleted from CC also. He's like, no, I've got the answer, reply. And then he would reply back and put me back in CC. But again, when the reply would come, I was not there. But it was a very good branch. We did very well. I think for about 2 years, we went on and then he didn't carry on with us. In 2011 is when we got our own office. So from working on one chair to requesting them to give us one little cabin where we used to do trainings, then we used to hire space to do trainings. In 2011 is when I said, okay, let's shift into our own office. And I was really kicked about it because it was in the same building as the NII office and it was slightly bigger than the NII office. So I was very kicked and I told KK, yay. In 2012, we started the Chandigarh branch. Why Chandigarh? Because my parents are from Chandigarh. I used to keep visiting, so I said, this sounds easy. Let's start in Chandigarh. In 2013, we started the Pune and the Thane branches. In 2013, we also won our first award, Education Leadership Award from DNA. A very, very proud day for me. 2014 is when my daughter was born.
Oh.
So, I still remember I was trying to go to office throughout my pregnancy, or at least when my doctor allowed me to go. And there was this one time when I was around 8.5 months pregnant and I had this huge belly and I went, you know, swaddling into office. Everybody from both the teams of ISN and I came to me, ma'am, what is it? We will manage, please go home. Because they were so scared and I'm going to pop any minute. Please go home, ma'am, we will manage. So we had a lovely team and they did manage. I think I missed out at around 2009 when we created our CIC course at the time when we hired our first all-time trainer. Molly, who's here with us today, she was a beautiful trainer and she's worked very hard in preparing some of the courses. We've got 72 new courses now. So we started with CIC in the journey. So 2014 is when my daughter was born. It became really tough to give time to my daughter, my little bundle of joy, and to office. And you know, it's really tough because at times you really need to choose. Because you need to go to office and you know your daughter is home and you want to spend as much time as you can with her. But I did do a lot of work from home, and what I started doing, in fact, I'm still doing, is I work after my children go to sleep. So lots of my emails you will receive are from 12 to 3 a.m. because that's the time my children have gone to sleep and that's the time I have to actually set up my system and do some work. So yes, it's been a tough journey, but in 2016 my son was born. 2015 was the toughest period when I had a little daughter, I was pregnant and I had my first baby, which was RIS. And I had to decide, okay, I have to juggle all the three balls and keep them in the air. It's 2017, we opened our new headquarter. Now, we were in a, how many of you have come to our old office, you know, it was a beautiful building, but the approach was through the tabela and the barbary. So KK, he's a very simple person, so he said, okay, we had our first office, the second office we opened in the same building, the third office we opened in the same building. And at this time, just after I had my child, he said, we're taking another office in the same building. And I said, no, please, no. Let's stop this. Let's take a better office and let's take one office, because it's tough to handle four different offices. So he said, I don't have the budget. I said, okay. If I can find something at the same budget, will you agree to shift? He said, okay, at the same budget, yes. So I spent a month, because I could go only for 2 hours a day when my child would sleep, to go and see offices. And I must have seen about 1,500 offices and shortlisted lots of them. But there was one office which I really liked, which was in the Navy West, because it was 10 minutes away from home. And it was a lovely building. So I tried to convince him, but that was really out of a budget. So I tried to convince him, let's please shift into the software. And he said, I don't have the budget for this. And we still had a couple more shortlisted options. And every time I would see a new office, I would keep saying, I want something like that building, because that is what I like. So ultimately, my property dealer said, let's just meet the owner. Mr. Roshan is the owner of this office. And he said, let's just meet him. And he's a nice guy, maybe we can negotiate a bit. Unfortunately, when we had the meeting, at that time KK had a flight. He was going for a project. So at the same time, he was on a flight. So he gave me a piece of paper and he said, okay, this is the rent, this is the deposit, and these are the numbers. If this, you can finalize, otherwise I'm sorry. So I went for this meeting and those numbers were crazy. It was at least one third less of what he was asking. So I went to this meeting with Mr. Roshan and he says, okay, so what is your offer? And I said, I know you asked for this and this is my offer. And he started laughing, literally started laughing. And he's like, that's not possible. I said, see, I have two children. I run this company and I'm going to promise you this. We are going to be here for a long while. You are going to get your checks on time. There will never be a single problem. But let's start on this number because we don't have the budget. If you say no, I'm going to end up going to market. So he agreed. He agreed and he said, okay, fine. Then I said, okay, this is not the only thing. And I took out a little paper and I said, okay, so I cannot give you 6 months deposit, I can only give you 4 months deposit, I need two months for fit out, blah, blah, blah. And he agreed to everything. So that's how our new office started. But that was just the beginning because it was a bare shell and we had to do all the interiors. And I know nothing about networking. So I had to first learn about networking. So this is our first office, which we went into from my one chair in the sales team. This is our Chandigarh branch, our Pune office, and this is our new headquarters. IAS has today become one of the most trusted sources of hands-on trainings in information security around the globe, with the backing of our brilliant technical team at Network Intelligence, who've been consulting since the last 16 years. We train, we mentor, we support our students' career in cybersecurity. You know, the first student we have had of our first batch of CISC, he's still working with us. He's a senior consultant today. He's working out of Dubai and he's doing so well in his career. So when people tell me, what is your biggest achievement? Our students are our biggest achievement. Really, this is where we are today. We've got 6 training centers in Mumbai, Pune, Delhi, Chandigarh, Bangalore, and Hyderabad. We train about 400 plus students a year. And we give 100% placement guarantee. We have actually placed each one of our students. And the reason we've been able to do this is because of the practical knowledge that we've given, because of the hands-on that we've given. We've conducted 120 plus customized corporate trainings. And we've got about 72 courses that we do, including cloud, blockchain, Internet of Things, malware analysis, to name a few. This is our training catalog. I won't go through it. We give trainings on all the delivery modes, classroom, everything. Corporate trainings, we customize the trainings as per the requirement of the corporates. You know, we have never put a single ad in the newspaper or anywhere. Our advertisement is the word of mouth of our students. And we make sure that they speak well about us. So here is what our students have to say about us. Now, you know, this is all the easy part. This is the story. Now to get to what were the difficulties, what were the problems? As a woman leading a technology firm who doesn't have any background in technology. So my biggest challenge was that I was always underestimated. They would always, people from our own company would always say, okay, she can't do this. And you know, they would not most of the time listen to me. But I made this into my biggest strength. I'm going to tell you this, it's a very silly story, but it's you know, in one of our offices, we had network issues. And we had these issues for a couple of months. So we asked all our technical, you know, these really educated, very well technically guys to do this. And they were looking at the problem from a mile high because they are that good at it. And they could not understand the problem. So one fine day, I said, okay, I'm going to solve this. And KK literally was like, but he is the one person who has always supported me. And he said, okay, if you've said this, then you will solve it, you will solve it. So I asked some of our trainers and some of the technical team, I said, please come, let's have a meeting on Saturday and let's solve this problem. And they said, ma'am, we have not been able to solve it. How will you solve it? So I went down and I said, okay, you are saying there's a problem with, what is it, the firewall or the switch. So let's do one thing, let's remove the firewall. Let's see now, that is there a network issue? And they're like, is this the way we are going to be working today? I said, yes, this is how you look at things from a different perspective. And believe me, we will find a solution. Just bear with me for these 2 hours. So we removed the firewall. Then we tried the network issue. There was a little issue still. I said, okay, let's remove the switch. And let's see if there is still a network issue through the firewall. And like this, every step of the network, we kept removing one thing. And okay, the network issue is actually solved. But the next day when we went back, network issue was there again. So, okay, so the problem is not just that, there's a bigger problem. The problem may be there are some rules in the firewall that are not working. So again I went, I said, okay, let's see if the firewall is working. Let's try, okay, can we play YouTube? No, ma'am, we can't. Like, can you play BitTorrent? No, we can't. All right. Then I asked my trainer, you know, how I saw you guys downloading a video. What is that other thing? So he said, oh, we tried this. I said, can you do that through this firewall? Yes, we can. So the problem, when we make rules, we made rules for some specific sites, but we need to make rule for that sort of a file. That, okay, any file that looks this big, and that is the problem, not just BitTorrents. So we changed the rules around, and our network problems were solved. And this was from someone who doesn't know networking, doesn't have any idea. So yes, I am underestimated, and that is why I make it my strength, and I go forward with it. Okay, balancing work and family life has always been tough for me. As I said many times, I have to go back home, wait for my children to sleep, and then get on my emails and answer mails, because you don't get time throughout the day to do what that is. Your nanny's on leave. Now what to do? You can't go to office also because your nanny's on leave. I have a 1.5-year-old and a 3.5-year-old. So what do you do? So yes, this I think is the time when men realize women are here to stay. Whether we have children, whether we are pregnant, whether we have the technical knowledge, we are here to stay. We have the expertise, we have the knowledge, we have the confidence, and we bring a different perspective, one that companies really need. You know, I made this mistake. I kept trying to fit in all the time. I kept trying to, you know, okay, I'm going to learn this and I'm going to learn this and then I will fit in. But I realized down the line, I don't have to fit in. Why am I trying to fit in? Why can't I just be myself, stand out? This is who I am and I'm working hard. And it's time that everybody realizes that I'm putting a lot of hard work in this as well. Just because I'm a woman doesn't mean that you disregard what I'm doing. Do you know that there are only 11% women in cybersecurity today? 11%. Women make 50% of the workforce, so why only 11% in cybersecurity? The future depends on diversity. If we have 4 million, the requirement is 4 million, and we have only 11% women, women is the answer, right? So what are the problems? The problems are pipeline and retention. Now, when I talk about a hacker, what do you pictureize? Is it something like this? If this is the perception of hackers, would women want to be hackers? So there is a problem in perception. Let's start from here. Let's change this perception. Why don't we have a single woman, a lady hacker? I mean, we have many, but why don't we have that perception? Why this? So this is one of the problems. Retention is the second problem. Why do people leave the field once they join? Burnout? Lack of career advancement? The basic industry culture? Most efforts to address a greater inclusion and diversity extend not beyond PR pitches. That's about it. And that's not really a substantial bite. So, we need to fix this. How? There are very strong female role models in cybersecurity. Some of them in this room with me today. We need to make role models and we need to make sure that people know about them. News outlets should stop citing only male experts. Why don't they cite female experts? We have to include female speakers in conferences. We have to have conferences such as these. Thank you so much. The ISACA team. We have to have talk shows. We have to reach out more to female experts. There are many experts, but the media is just not bringing them out. Because if we don't see it, we won't be it. Women must be visible and seen as experts. And then we say, okay, this is where I want to get. This is who I want to follow. It is time for us to break the glass ceiling. It's our time to soar. Be proud of who you are. And never try to fit in. I make this mistake, don't make this mistake. Stand out. And this is something my father told my sister and me, and this is the thought I want to leave you all with. Being a woman, you can do what any man can do in half the time with half the resources. Thank you so much.